Mr. Gaurav, Dwivedi, CEO of MyGov, Ministry of Electronics and IT, Government of India. Mr. Dwivedi has been serving as the CEO of MyGov since September 2014. Mr. Dwivedi started his career in IAS as an assistant collector in Kerala before moving to Chhattisgarh. He was associated with National E-Governance Program of India, and in 2014 he has taken over as the CEO of MyGov. Apart from being a guest of honor, he is also representing the Secretary of the Government of India, Minister of Electronics and Information Technology. Mr. Dwivedi will be presenting on the topic Infusing Enterprise Architecture into Digital India Towards a National Strategy. Dr.
Good morning, Sir Narayan sir, Steve, James, everyone. Friends, as I was introduced, so I represent the Secretary, Ministry of Electronics and IT, Mrs. Aruna Sundararajan, who was initially selected to be here today, but due to some other urgent work, she was unable to make it. And it's a fairly exhaustive presentation just now about the different kinds of things that the Open Group is doing. And I'm sure many of you would have been familiar with all of those things. Some new things that you would have also seen. And certainly it was a good learning opportunity for me. Because one has heard about enterprise architecture for a while. But really this is something that within the government, although the broad elements are there or they are starting to come in, but government-wide adoption of enterprise architecture is something which is still work in progress, and it's going to take some time before the entire range of government activities is brought within the ambit. As you're all aware, governance in India in any case is a fairly complicated business. The division of powers between the central government, the state governments, and then subsequently to the local bodies as well, the constitutional amendments of the 90s. So we have the government of India, we have the respective state governments, we have the panchayats, we have the municipal corporations and municipalities. So the separation of roles between all of them as envisaged by the constitution also makes it a little tricky in terms of how to implement a system like enterprise architecture. Because the roles, the rights, the responsibilities, the privileges that are available to different levels of government and different parts of the government are rather clearly defined, but at the same time there's a fair amount of overlap which also exists there. For those of you who've been following the evolution of the IT and e-governance systems in India, you would have noted that there have been fairly substantive changes and improvements that have been made in the systems way back in the 80s when the railways first came up with the e-governance system in the form of the ticketing solution. And this was around the same time that the NIC was also set up, the National Informatics Center, and which gradually spread its presence across the country, not only within the ministries in the government of India but subsequently to the states and then down to the district level as well. It was probably a feature of those times that since connectivity and the level of understanding and appreciation of IT and e-governance systems wasn't really that high within the government. So many districts, many states tried to evolve their own models of e-governance. As a result, although there were certain areas which were performing very well, there were some very interesting and very, very good initiatives that were adopted. But there was also a fair amount of replication and reinvention of the wheel which was going on. So for the same kind of problem, there would probably be a district collector somewhere in Andhra Pradesh who comes up with a solution. But at the same time, there would be somebody else in Rajasthan or somebody in Assam who's also creating a system. And over a period of time, we find, you know, about 3 years back, Satyanarayan sir was then our boss in the ministry. And I see compiled a list of the different solutions that had been created for various governance activities. And it turned out that, if I remember the figure correctly, it was more than 3,000 different softwares for different activities were created. But almost maybe 30 to 40% of them were solutions for the same subject, for the same governance issue, which were created at the same time in different states or in different districts. Now, logic dictates that this kind of a replication, this kind of a duplication should not take place because it ties up resources and it also prevents us from optimizing the efforts that have been made. But due to the lack of connectivity, due to the lack of the ability to share knowledge, and also probably due to the lack of something like the Clinger Act in the US, which made it a mandate for IT systems to ensure that optimization was ensured in creation of new IT systems. What started happening was that many of the states started forging ahead. Many of the states were a little further behind. To address these things, in the middle of the last decade, the government of India came up with the NEGP, the National E-Governance Plan, and many of you would have heard of it, many of you probably would have also participated in some of the programs that were taken up under the NEGP. So connectivity through the statewide area networks, data center services through the state data center program, the e-district, the common services centers, many of these programs were taken up and met with a substantial amount of success. But then it's the nature of technology to keep evolving. It's the nature of IT systems to keep growing and keep changing their form within a few years. So about 2 years back, the government of India now adopted the Digital India program, and you can see the logo at the bottom right of the panel behind me. And the Digital India program is probably the most concerted effort by the government to ensure that the most optimal IT solutions are adopted, and not only adopted within a particular department, within a particular ministry, but adopted government-wide. Now, when we talk about adoption of systems government-wide or enterprise-wide, if you would prefer the other word, I would say that this runs a little bit counter to the way that we've been learning throughout our academic careers. As we grow, as we proceed from school to college, university, and specialized programs, we are told that you are supposed to gain more and more knowledge about less and less. And that's what somebody once defined an expert as, a person who knows more and more about less and less. So you become too specialized, you get into these niches, and gradually there is a lack of an enterprise-wide focus which starts happening. Because of which, whatever a group of people in a part of the organization are doing, the other people are either not aware of it or they are not able to really appreciate it. And which is why the learning, the knowledge, the developments that have taken place in one part of the organization are often not adopted in another. And the result is, again, duplication, replication, reinvention. Some of the elements of enterprise architecture have started coming up within the government of India in the last few years. Now, I can see some of my colleagues from NIC, Mr. B.C. Mishra and his team. So they have been working on these enterprise frameworks in a couple of ministries, and I'm sure later there will be some presentations and discussions about the work that they've been doing in the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, as well as the Water and Sanitation, DWS, and some other ministries. But one of the major things that has happened in the last few years is the creation of Aadhaar, the Unique ID Authority, and again, Satyanarayan sir currently is also the chairman of UIDAI. And I think this is one of the most important building blocks towards an enterprise approach to the government, which has evolved over the last few years. Again, some of you would have heard about the different numbers that are associated with Aadhaar, the largest biometric identity system anywhere in the world. Close to about 1.1 billion people have been enrolled and registered whose biometrics are available within the system. But Aadhaar by itself doesn't mean anything. It's an identity system, yes, but the real benefit that is coming out of Aadhaar is to be able to use this across the government as an identifier of all the people who are availing different governance services. Initially, there was a little bit of a legal conundrum about the status of Aadhaar with the passage of the Aadhaar Act in the Parliament. I think that also has been resolved very substantially. And we found that across the government, Aadhaar is being leveraged to be able to really identify the people correctly and to be able to provide services to them in the most efficiently targeted manner possible. One of the very interesting numbers that came up a few months back, this was part of the Prime Minister's speech, that using Aadhaar, the different ministries who've been providing different government services, and especially the subsidy-related programs, have been able to eliminate a fairly substantial large number of ghost and fake beneficiaries. And the benefits that have already accumulated on this account exceed about $6.5 billion. Not million, $6.5 billion. More than 36,000 to 40,000 crore rupees have been already saved by leveraging this. And the effort is still going on. Another example that has come up in the last few months is the National Scholarship Portal. As again, many of you would be aware that there are a very large number of government initiatives targeting students across different communities and specifically targeting, say, people from weaker sections or women students, providing them scholarships for education at all levels. When a list was made, it was found that there are about 11 different ministries and departments in the Government of India itself which are involved in the process of giving scholarships of various sorts. The total number of such scholarship programs was, I think, more than about 5 dozen. But each program, each scheme, each ministry, each department had its own set of rules, had its own set of procedures, and it made it very, very cumbersome for a student or his parents, his or her parents, to be able to really identify which is the appropriate scholarship, what are the scholarships that you're eligible for, and how to go about obtaining it. So bringing together the efforts of the different ministries, of the different departments involved in this process, a unified scholarship portal was set up by the Government of India a few months back. And I think this is a sea change in the approach that the government, that the way that the government has been functioning. Because each ministry, each organization in the government is always known for guarding its turf very, very fiercely. There's a fair amount of domain battles which go on in the government at all levels. And the adoption of the scholarship portal itself shows that the mindset within the government has been changing very, very substantially. Now there is a unified portal. All the different ministries that are involved in giving scholarships of various sorts have rationalized their procedures, common systems, and for each of the people, each of the students who are applying, gradually the Aadhaar seeding of their databases is also taking place, which means that instead of months for the scholarship amount to be released from the Government of India to the state government on to the concerned organization or to the district and then passing on to the student, process which would actually easily take several months can now be done in a matter of minutes from the moment of sanction. The Aadhaar related bank accounts, the money passes straight from the Government of India into the beneficiary's account. So as you can see that there is a growing appreciation and understanding of the way an enterprise system can deliver the goods, and some very interesting work is going on again in Satyanarayan sir's leadership and guidance, and he'll be there in the next session to talk about the work that he's been doing in the e-Pragati system in Andhra, as well as the work that he's doing as chairman of the Empowered Committee on enterprise framework development within the Government of India. So on that note, on that optimistic note, I will conclude my remarks. I will again convey the regards of my secretary and the Ministry of Electronics and IT to everybody present here, and we look forward to a day of very interesting deliberations and a lot of learning. Thank you very much.